Welcome. We are here today to interview Todd and Damian. They live in PA with three dogs. Todd, where are you originally from?
Originally from Maine.
Okay, and Damian, where are you originally from?
Originally from here in Pennsylvania.
Okay, well, welcome. Today you're here because we have a project we are researching on social responsibility and sociology, and our issue is same-sex marriage. How can we as a society embrace differences and accept change? I'm going to go ahead and ask you one question from Jacques from Iowa. And he asks, when you both told your families, how supportive were they in your marriage?
Actually, my mom wanted to be there. Mom and dad wanted to come. They unfortunately couldn't come. Okay. How supportive were yours?
My dad's very supportive. My parents are divorced, so my dad and stepmother are very supportive. My mother and stepfather, unfortunately, are not. So we actually don't have a relationship right now.
I'm sorry to hear that. Tanika from Alaska asks, if you both want children, how are you going to raise them? And if so, how would they interact with both genders?
Well, our grandparents are strictly involved in our life. I mean, my mom and dad would be around. His sister has two girls, and they're here all the time. So it wouldn't even be a question.
Yes,
to not knowing the other sex. There's always a female present everywhere at all times.
Yeah, but they would be raised knowing that they have two dads and that it's okay and that it's fine. I think we talked about children a couple times and we keep going back and forth. It's just very difficult, especially in the state that we live in, because in Pennsylvania it's very difficult for two men or two women to adopt children. So the process, it's basically you have to pay a lot of money if you want children. So I think we've talked about it a lot, but they would be raised in a normal household just like we were.
Okay, good. Agatha from Baltimore, Maryland asks, how would you have your children call you?
Dad.
Just
dad.
Okay, all right, good. Crystal from Minnesota asks, society makes gay coupling difficult and it targets you for discrimination. How does the outside world treat you in public? And what are the daily challenges you both face?
Well, as far as like personally, there aren't any challenges. The challenges come in when you want equal rights. That becomes a problem. But when people perceive myself or Damian when he's out in public, we're just as hated or loved as anybody else.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I don't think that, I think I kind of look at it, you know, living in a small town, coming from a big city, we thought that there could be potentially, you know, a problem. But I think that we kind of live our lives as who we are. We don't conform our lives to meet what other people think we should be. So basically, I think if they have a problem with our lives, then it's a problem that they have and not a problem that we have, and we're not going to change who we are to conform to what they think we should be. As far as discriminations, I mean, all my employers have always known, Todd's employers have always known, they know we're together, they know we're married, it's just a non-issue.
Since we're talking about employers, Deborah from Georgia, she does say, I am a nurse, and she works with healthcare. She says a traditional married couple has no problem obtaining family coverage through an employer's insurance plan. Has this been a problem for you, or does your plan allow a same-sex?
No, it's a big problem. It's a big problem. I work for a major cruise line, and it's very ironic that they'll help me out. There's certain things that they are totally accepting of.
Right, like I can, and with this cruise line, I can get all the benefits of a spouse,
yes,
but I can't be on his
health
insurance. So I can travel around the world for free,
yes,
but they won't cover me with their health insurance. Now, as far as my covering him, I'm self-employed, so it would be a matter of adding him to my personal health insurance.
Okay.
But of course, at that point, you're paying an exorbitant amount of money because they feel that we're a risk. Mm-hmm.
But if we were legally married in the state of Pennsylvania, which we are married, just not in Pennsylvania, I could probably he'd be covered under my insurance, or I'd be covered under his.
And I think the bigger with the health issues, the bigger problem is, you know, if one of us goes into the hospital and we get to the point of where we can't make medical decisions for each other, there's a lot of legal paperwork that we have to go through. Like, I have to sign documents allowing Todd to make decisions for me, and vice versa, where
okay,
we may not be able to make them for ourselves. So we currently just maintain powers of attorney for each other, so we both have the rights to do everything for each other.
Yeah, it's kind of sad. A legally married couple doesn't carry a power of attorney with them in case of an emergency.
Right.
Where
but a gay couple that aren't allowed to be legally married in the state they live in have to carry that in case he gets in a car wreck and I survive, but he has to go into surgery and they have to notify the next of kin. I have to carry a legal power of attorney to make those decisions for him, which is ironic because if you're a married couple, of course the spouse would make the decisions for the spouse.
Well, since we're talking about you not being married in the state, as we like to see this move forward, may I ask, where were you both married?
In Oia, Greece.
In Greece? Okay. Yep.
And we actually, in Greece, it's very interesting because we were the first gay couple to be married in Oia, because there was a big uprising and there was people that were, there was riots and everything, and they finally, we actually had a justice of the peace that was willing to do it for us, so we actually made local news in Greece. We were the first.
We had no idea. It was a shock to us there. After getting married in Greece. We were told that we were the first same-sex
couple in the country.
It's amazing. There are more countries that allow same-sex marriage, and the United States only has, I think, six, I believe.
Damian did research before he came to see me about what country we could be married in, and out of all of the countries, you had to either be a resident of a year, or there were you go to school there, or there had to be something that made you a citizen of that country or a resident at the time for a certain amount of time of that country.
So when we got married in Greece, we really didn't think that it was going to be legally recognized anywhere. We just did it because it's a beautiful place and we love the country and we love the people there. And it turns out that like the day before the ceremony, they asked if we wanted it to be a legal...
Yeah, we were going to do a commitment ceremony.
Yeah.
So that he could legally travel with me with the company that I work for as a spouse, because they would recognize that. And then the Justice of the Peace asked if we would want her to perform a legal ceremony.
Okay.
So we were officially legally married in...
Unless you live in Pennsylvania.
Yeah, true.
I'm from PA, so I understand. There's a question that we as a group collaborated with each other, and many states like Chicago, Chicago isn't a state, but many states like California, New York City, Minnesota, Rhode Island, New Mexico, they protect gender identity and they have access to marriage of the same sex. Countries such as Denmark, France, Spain, Belgium, Netherlands, and Germany now support same-sex marriage. Brazil even allows rights to inherit each other's pension and social security. Harvard, Stanford, Southern United Methodist University, Walt Disney, Ford, General Motors, Delta, Merrill Lynch, Mobil, and Walmart offer their employees domestic partner benefits. How do you feel, and I think this is redundant of the same question how would you feel if society is changing, what would you like to see happen?
Well, I think that we need to get away from the domestic partnership thing, because why should what we have be considered a domestic partnership whenever a heterosexual couple would be called a marriage? I think there's no difference. I don't want to be a domestic partner. I can live with Todd anywhere and be a domestic partner. It's really, we're married in any state regardless. We don't need the piece of paper from that state telling us that. We already know what we have. Mm-hmm. But it would be nice in relationship to like taxes. You know, if I can't claim Todd on my income tax, we can't do a joint filing. I pay an exorbitant amount of income tax to the state of Pennsylvania, and so does Todd, and I can't take deductions. We can't buy property together. We have to go through a whole legal thing to get our houses in each other's name and to claim each other on different things. So there's a lot of legal paperwork that we have to go through to get the same rights as a heterosexual married couple that just come automatic to them. So I think that's the biggest thing I'd like to change.
Pension thing, if you're married with somebody or you're living with somebody for 20 years and you consider yourself a married couple, It's amazing that a male and a female, the female or the male, could get the pension.
Right.
But two guys or two women living together in this state, even though they had been together for 20 years, left alone, did their own thing, once one of them passes away, the other one is not able to claim any of those benefits.
Or even just investments.
If one of them had a more influential job, had a better pension, now we're looking at mortgage payments if their house isn't paid for, car payments, insurances, medical, all of that stuff that they combine together is now left up to one to fend for themselves because the other one doesn't have any rights claiming any of that pension.
Right. Or property. So like, for example,
the property could be taken away from
if we live together for 20 years and we build, you know, a certain amount of an estate, just for the sake of a better word, you know, if we own properties or cars or whatever, you know, if something would happen to one of us, the other one would have to fight to get the things that they helped build the whole way, which is just, it's absurd.
And sometimes families will step in. Money does really crazy things to people. And sometimes families that haven't recognized their marriage, and any mom or dad could not like the other person's spouse. That can happen in a straight relationship or a gay relationship. It doesn't matter. But in a gay relationship, if the family wants to step in and they never approved of the relationship, after X amount of years that they've been together, that family can try to take claim of everything that they had together.
Wow.
Because the partner doesn't have the rights.
And we've had times where this has happened, where there's been couples that have been together for 10 years and something happens, unfortunately, to one of them, and that whichever one passes away, the family would come in and take everything from the other one, and they built that life together. Yes. So how is that right?
Right. Now, I'm thinking outside the box here with some of the questions I've been asking you. This is a personal question for me. How would you feel about moving to a state that does allow same-sex? Would any of these things change for you?
If there was a job opportunity in that state, or mm-hmm. it was a state that we wanted to move to, we moved back here to be close to family.
Okay.
So it's very ironic that we moved here for family, yet we're not considered a family. It's very bizarre.
But also, we're not going to live somewhere that we're not going to be forced to live somewhere just because we can be married there. That's ridiculous. I mean, what are we going to put us in concentration camps? That's
right.
Absurd. Why should we have to live in Vermont because we're allowed to be married there? It's the United States. We're supposed to be free everywhere.
Exactly. Right.
So we should be allowed to live wherever we choose and be accepted wherever we choose to live. We shouldn't be forced into a ghetto-type atmosphere to where you have to live in this place. And the next thing they'll be telling us what food we have to eat, and that's just absurd. We're not going to conform our lives or where we live to meet what the government thinks they can tell us to do. We're just not going to do it.
Good, good. Now, I do have a question. We're getting into some of the meat of the matter. And this seemed to be a good one that we just brought up. Another one that we have is from philosopher William Bennett. Writes, marriage is natural theology, instituted by God and built on moral, religious, sexual, and human realities. It is an institute through which we propagate, nurture, educate, and sustain our species. Religious arguments condemn this act as immoral, and many people justify tolerance of lesbian and gay society as unnatural. Some argue that the Bible never mentions homosexuality, and that is interpreted in different ways. What is your opinion on the moral issues that are addressed?
I think that if you look at it from a moral point of view, and we're very spiritual people, I think that you can interpret the Bible a billion different ways. I think you're looking at a collaborative work, a book that was written thousands of years ago that people are interpreting and has changed over the years. I think that the biggest thing, which we have mentioned before, is you talk about in Christian religion, God is supposed to be all-loving. Well, if God is all-loving and all-accepting, then how can he not accept us? So how can it be wrong or immoral? How can anybody be in that case? I think that from a spiritual point of view, we have our beliefs in what we believe, and from what we believe, it's just be kind to everybody and accept everybody no matter who they are. And I think that religion has kind of lost that, and it's more of a control thing. I'm certainly not condemning religion. Everybody's entitled to their own beliefs. But I think that you need to, if you have your beliefs, just like I would not put my beliefs on you, I would hope that the churches would not put their beliefs on me. And I think that the most important thing is keeping church and state separated to where the churches do not get involved in government decisions that will affect our lives.
Yeah, and you know, for me, I don't pretend to understand the Bible. There's a lot in the Bible that I will probably never understand. Just like I don't 100% understand everything about myself. I'm learning. I'm a growing vessel that is educating himself and understanding things every day. And at 40, it's a time for me to just try really hard to accept everybody for what they are. Even though I don't believe or understand their religion or why they believe what they believe, I try to, as unconditionally as I can, because nothing is unconditional, 100%, as unconditionally as I can, I try to accept everybody for who they are. And I just ask them to do the same.
Good.
And I think if more people did that...
You always go back to they say that man should not live with man. Well, at the same time, they say that if a child, or if you steal from your neighbor, that you should be put to death or stoned. So, I mean, what are we actually believe? I mean, how literally are we taking it? So I think that's, they also talk about, there's 13 references to homosexuality in the Bible, where there's hundreds of references to heterosexuality. And the joke is, well, apparently heterosexuals need more control and guidance than the heterosexuals, because we're only mentioned 13 times, where the heterosexuals are mentioned much more. So they need more control there. So I think spirituality is a personal thing. I think that you need to have your own beliefs and everything, and as long as you don't inflict pain or harm on others, then I don't have a problem with any of it. And I think that...
Okay, good.
You know.
Now, do you support the opinion of PFLAG, which is Parents and Friends of Lesbians and Gays, that believe that being gay is biologically determined, or do you support the fundamentalists that believe it is by choice?
We're absolutely a big advocate of PFLAG, which is the short term of what you're talking about.
Okay.
I know within myself, and nobody can change that, that is absolutely genetically inbred into me. Science has proven that gay people have an extra Y or X chromosome. It's been scientifically proven. So the fact that it's a choice, I think is, at least for us, it is not even a possibility. It's no more a possibility for me to be with a woman than it would be for you to be with a woman. So, I mean, it's just that it's a genetic inbred thing. It's just like having blue eyes and brown hair.
Okay. I don't know why anybody would want to choose to be something that an entire group of people hate. Mm-hmm. You know, to conform to something and to be more comfortable and more widely accepted would be so much easier. Being a kid and trying to figure out who you are is already bad enough.
Right.
When you have bullies, which is a huge thing right now, these kids in school, you know, you get bullied because you're fat, you get bullied because you have glasses,
mm-hmm.
you get bullied because you're black, you get bullied because you're white, you know, Chinese,
that's
Jewish,
going on
Catholic,
with our next...
you get bullied because you're gay, and all of these kids, without organizations like PFLAG, these kids have nowhere to turn.
Mm-hmm.
So regardless if they are going to grow to be gay or lesbian, bisexual, they need an organization that will accept them for who they are.
Okay.
Every child goes through so much mm-hmm. turmoil and discovery, and it's just virtually impossible to think that that child could take a turn and end their life
mm-hmm.
because no one understands or no one accepts
but
them
I think
for who they are.
Getting back to your question, I think it's definitely a genetic thing
mm-hmm.
because like Todd started to mention, why would anybody choose to be disowned from their family, outcast of society, hated,
there's
potentially
so many
in danger.
That
why would you do that? Why would we go through all the stuff that we're fighting for if it was a choice? It's simply not a choice.
Now, Todd, you were actually going on with the question that I'm going to ask you next, which is great. Could you just elaborate a little bit on this? The stories of some tragic teens that have lost their lives due to bullying, such, for example, Lawrence King, and there's many others, the bullying that they faced in school, what kind of advice would you give these teens?
I belonged to an outreach program when I was a kid. It was gay, bisexual, lesbian, those questioning their gender, anybody under 21. I found this organization, I belonged to it, I spoke at a lot of outreach programs that we went to, parent-teacher organizations, we went into schools. It was an amazing experience for me. And I would get passed notes from kids in the audience, or parents would come up to me and say, my partner and I have been together and no one knows that we're lesbian. You know, we've worked in the school district and we're afraid. It's organizations like you. If we had organizations like you when we were younger,
mm-hmm.
you know, this was when I was 19, you know, I lost a job due to it. I was working for a hospital and I took the day off work to go to a parent-teacher organization. The kids wanted us, they were doing a sexual awareness week, and they asked if this outreach program could come and speak at their school. And let me tell you, it was very controversial. The parents, half of them didn't want us, the kids demanded we came. We went, and it was on the news. And I went to work the next day, and though my supervisor shook my hand and said she was very proud of me, the people that she worked for deemed that I wasn't fit for duty because I was a homosexual, and I got fired from my job. So, I mean, everybody in, I think, that has been gay, everybody that's gay and lesbian has some kind of discrimination in their life. And if you can find an organization that will accept you for who you are, it's just an amazing thing.
And you were asking, what would you advice to give? There's a group called It Gets Better. It's the It Gets Better Project. It's founded by Dan Savage. He's an amazing person. And I think the biggest thing I can say is that just hang in there. It does get better. You can have kind of everything that we have. We've got a great life. So find an organization like Todd's talking about. You need to find it, and I'm very passionate about this. It gets so much better. It just gets so much better.
You know, not everybody's going to have a parent that's going to accept them. Not everybody's going to have a friend that's going to accept them.
Right.
not everybody's going to find that what they're looking for. And it's a shame that in today's day and age, we're in the year 2012, and we still find that there are hate groups out there. There are hate groups on every different nationality, every different religion, black or white. They're hate groups against gay and lesbian people. And if a young child growing up has all of these issues on their shoulders, and they're trying to find themselves, and they find that society doesn't accept them for who they are, they're going to turn to illegal drug use. They're going to turn to being very disruptive to their body. They're going to do mutilation. They're going to start,
or suicide,
and you know, the last thing that they're going to turn to. I was getting to that too, and the last thing they're going to turn to when they can't find someone that accepts them for who they are is suicide.
Yeah.
And we find kids all over the world killing themselves because they're not accepted. They're not skinny enough. They're not pretty enough. They're not. They didn't make it on the football team. Their girlfriend broke up with them. There are other rooted problems behind a boy killing himself because his girlfriend broke up with him, or a boy killing himself because the boys at school keep beating him up in the locker room and making fun of him, or the girl got beat up and got killed. You see it in the news all the time because they called her fat and they picked on her every day. Mm-hmm. You know, bullies are out there, and for a kid who already has issues,
or is already struggling with their sexuality, you
know, already struggling with, and with,
they already are not liking themselves because right. society tells them that they're not good enough. So then to have that, in addition to having kids are very cruel. So
yes.
you know, to have kids, you know, constantly bullying you, and you already having the insecure feeling in yourself, I mean, it could potentially lead to suicide. That's why the It Gets Predator Project, I can't endorse it enough. I'm a huge advocate.
Okay.
There's books out there. I donate books constantly to all the high school libraries. It's one of the big things. You can go to their website and you can donate a book to the local library. I know that I sent one to my high school. We sent one to the high school here in the town that we live in. So I think the most important thing is that if you're a kid and you don't know what's going on with inside your own body, you need to just find a group and just talk to somebody.
The internet's a good resource now too. I mean, you can research organizations in your community. That well, there's hopefully like an outreach program everywhere. You know, there's organizations for youth. Every school should have the ability. A guidance counselor should have the ability to have an open door that a child can go in and ask them any questions.
I agree.
You know, they give out condoms in some schools for teen pregnancy. So that young boy or that young girl who's questioning their sexuality should also be able to walk in that door and say, listen, I have this thing going on and I don't really know how to deal with it.
We're going to wrap it up with one more question. You guys did a phenomenal job answering these questions. I thank you both. I think that it was, we really did get to the meat of the matter, and that's exactly what I wanted.
Yeah,
so it was perfect. We're just going to probably lighten this up a little bit with one last question. And it is just, if you can just briefly just give me a leading stereotype that people misinform, you
just,
know, regarding.
Just one?
Yes.
The biggest one is that.
Who's the girl?
Who's the girl in the relationship? I think that's hilarious. I think that's probably the biggest one. Why does there have to be a girl in the relationship? Everybody asks that.
It's amazing how uncomfortable they are with the relationship already. And the first question they always ask is,
which one of you
plays the lady? And it, you know, it's.
And for us, it's kind of comical because we're in our 40s and we've dealt with all of these issues for you know, 20, 30 plus years. So, I think to answer that is that why does there have to be a girl? I mean, if either of us wanted to be with a girl, then we would be. It would be a whole different genetic makeup, and we would be straight. I think so.
Okay.
I think that's the biggest one is who has to be.
You know, there's
the
a lot
girl.
Of
there's so
I mean,
many.
There's tons, but that you get, and you know, it's not gay people that ask you which one's the girl because they already know. You know that neither one. They know your relationship. They can tell just by looking at you, talking to you. It's always straight people that ask the question.
Right. Well, we're just equal.
Which one of you is,
we're just,
you know,
we just happen to both be men.
Right. I think we just are curious ourselves, and that's why we're here together to question
right.
The both of you. And I applaud you for everything that you stand for, and for the changes that hopefully with the president that's in office, and maybe with the future president, we can try to move this forward into more of a civilized and more for equal
I'll leave you with one last thing. There's an amazing person on the planet right now that is on daytime television. Everybody can turn the channel and watch a little bit of Ellen. You can research Ellen, mm-hmm. and you can just listen to what Ellen says. She is profound. She mm-hmm. is amazing. She has done so much for equal rights. Mm-hmm. And just pay attention to her. Just spend one day with her.
And it's not about gay rights.
And then make your choice.
Equal rights. It's not gay rights. It's just human equality. Everybody deserves to be the same.
Yes. And that's why we're here today. So I do applaud you. And thanks again for coming today. And I wish you the best.
Thanks.
And hopefully as we move forward, we'll see a brighter tomorrow. So thanks again, gentlemen.
Thank you.
All right.
Come stop your crying, it will be alright. Just take my hand, hold it tight. I will protect you from all around you. I will be here, don't you cry. For one so small, you seem so strong. My arms will hold you, keep you safe and warm. This bond between us can't be broken. I will be here, don't you cry. 'Cause you'll be in my heart. Yes, you'll be. They can't explain. I know we're different, but deep inside us, we're not that different at all. And you'll be in my heart. Yes, you'll be in my heart. From this day. Just look over your shoulder. Just look over.